am fired up! Rocket fuel in the veins! You know what? I hope they meet in the playoffs!
Me too!
You're telling me you don't want 4-7 games of that?
That is, that's exactly what I'm telling you, yeah.
Honestly, fair, I was only doing it because you were doing it and I wasn't sure when to stop.
Let's go!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a little ridiculous.
Good boy.
Play all the hits!
Left Toronto Maple Leafs.
So let me finish. How am I supposed to go to bed after watching that?
I'm quite hyped.
With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Puppies, Iggy, and not only did the Leafs beat the Bruins, the Leafs beat the Bruins on Iggy's birthday! Catch it, buddy! Oh, no!
We get another try. We get another try. It's your birthday. I didn't see the first one. I didn't see it.
You got it! High five for your birthday. Yeah!
Before I do the fist bump thing, I will not hear any slander about my Santa Claus pajamas! I didn't have any more sweatpants, they're all in the laundry, so I wore my Santa Claus pajamas. Steve, don't you own jeans? Of course I own jeans! What am I gonna do, wear them at my house? At 11:14 at night! I know how I come across! I'm not that far gone. Anyway, ho ho ho. Leafs win! 6-4 over the Boston Bruins!
In Boston.
Oh, I love when the Leafs beat the Bruins in Boston!
It'd just be nice if they didn't have to lose three, like, pretty important players off their roster to do it. All right, geez, for goodness sake, how to talk about this game? Why do the Bruins always make it so difficult to talk about every game? Why do the Bruins in Boston? Like, I feel like games don't get this out of hand in Toronto. Feels like very often when games pop off, the Leafs are on the road. The Jets, Spezza gets suspended, that was on the road. Matthews gets suspended against the Sabres, that was technically on the road, even though it was in Hamilton. So like, if you don't mind, here's how I'm gonna talk about the game. There were 10 goals, so first I'm gonna do the score. Like, here's who was winning and losing. And then after I do the score, I'm gonna try to get into the shenanigans. Because if I try to do the whole thing in chronological order, everything's gonna get lost. Because it's funny, even though there were 10 goals in this game, if you just look at the goals beyond the shenanigans, the game was pretty simple. Because the game started tight, and then the Leafs opened it wide, and the Bruins weren't able to slam it shut. So let's talk about it. Right out the gate, Sheldon Keefe had to feel happy about this. New look fourth line. There was buzz today that it was gonna be Nick Eberzese making his NHL debut on the fourth line with Colin Blackwell and Jason Spezza. Looking at how this game ended up going, aren't we glad that didn't happen? Like, dude, even when I saw the report, I was like, yeah, oh. I'm excited for the kid. I think Eberzese could be a really good player for the Leafs. First game on the road in Boston as a member of the Toronto Maple Leafs? Who told you that was a good idea? And instead, he is replaced with a bearded pair of fists in Kyle Clifford, and I'm like, that's more like it. Like, I'm sorry, if you're gonna head into Boston and take Wayne Simmonds out of the lineup, you cannot replace him with a 5'9" rookie fresh out of school playing his first NHL game. That is not a baptism by fire, that is a baptism by volcano. So Kyle Clifford gets into the game, and he factors into the first goal. Puck gets fired into the Bruins' end. Now, granted, it takes a funny bounce off the glass. That is no one's fault. But Swayman and Connor Clifton are playing hot potato with the puck, and Kyle Clifford applies pressure. That leads to an errant pass. It leads to Jason Spezza getting the puck, and Colin Blackwell heads straight to the net. Tip in, goal! Spezza's not gonna miss that pass, and Blackwell is not gonna miss that net. 1-0 Leafs off Blackwell's first as a Leaf. But remember, we're in Boston. And just as they're talking on the broadcast about Michael Bunting and the way he changes the dynamic of the Leafs and Bruins playing each other, he takes a penalty. Very literally 200 feet from his own net. A $1.99 at least. It was an accident. It also was bad. Like, from a first line player. He's a first line player on this team. You can't do that. What happens? The Bruins get a power play. David Pastrnak puts it on and off. TJ Brody puts it into his own net. Against Peter Mrazek. And I gotta say, dating back to the Buffalo game, the outdoor game, I think the guy who has the most goals against Peter Mrazek is TJ Brody. He's got at least 2! And after that, Mrazek leaves the game. And we do gotta pause a minute to talk about that. Dude, I feel sick to my stomach for this guy. Like, he's really struggled in his first season, if you can even call it that, with the Leafs. People talk about his struggles in net, struggles to play. Well, it's no wonder that he's played some of the worst hockey of his career when his season didn't even get to begin. Plays his first game, out, comes back, hurt again, comes back, plays some games, COVID shutdown, goes through the worst stretch of his career, finally comes out of it. He only allowed 2 goals in each of his last 2 games. and then this. And Sheldon Keefe says it sounds like he's going to miss some time. So now beyond the Leafs throwing Eric Shellgren in net, they now have to call up Joseph Woll. Oh, they can't, because he's hurt too. Yes, Jack Campbell is going to come back, but we don't know when. The Leafs goaltending situation is a mess right now. So to talk about what they have down on the Marlies, here's Nick Barden from theleafsnation.com. He has a YouTube channel where he talks all about the Leafs and all about the Marlies.
So with Peter Mrazek getting injured in the game versus Boston, Michael Hutchinson was held out of the Marlies game tonight in Abbotsford, and that meant the next player to come in line and play would be Keith Petruzzelli, but he was also held out of this game due to precautionary reasons because of an illness, and that meant two e-bugs for the Toronto Marlies in tonight's game against Abbotsford. I gotta use my phone for this. Tavin Grant and Taylor Joseph are the two players. Grant last played with the Prince George Cougars of the WHL in 2017, posting an .892 save percentage in 37 games, while Joseph is coming in from Trinity Western University, where he had an .876 save percentage in 12 games this season. And one of the interesting things is Joseph was only coming to back up for Michael Hutchinson, and then when Hutchinson got the call, it looked like Joseph was coming in and he was the starter. So again, Tavin Grant was the backup tonight for the Marlies and Taylor Joseph was the starter, with Hutchinson up with the Leafs, Petruzzelli out with an illness.
In case you didn't understand what Nick just said, the Marlies' starter tonight was an emergency goalie. Their backup was an emergency goalie. Because Michael Hutchinson was called up to the Leafs and there was another player in there that Nick Barden brought up named Keith Petruzzelli. Now, he's had good numbers this year in the ECHL. But the thing about Keith Petruzzelli is the Leafs can't call him up. Not because he's not good enough, because they literally can't call him up. He's not on an NHL contract. So it looks like for Thursday's game, it's going to be Shellgren and Hutchinson. Rushing back Jack Campbell is not an option. You need him to be as good as possible for the Stanley Cup playoffs. And at this point, Eric Shellgren maybe the backup comes Stanley Cup playoffs, depending how bad the injury is to Mrazek. The Leafs goaltending situation is bad. Not because I don't trust Eric Shellgren, although he is a brand spanking new rookie, but because they're like an injury away from literally running out of goaltenders. What about Carter Hutton? What about Carter Hutton? Where's he? It's a lot of fun, and speaking of a lot of fun, the Leafs just lost a goalie after allowing a power play goal to the Boston Bruins. This could go bad real quick. But born from a play that could have gone really bad really quick, the Leafs gain a lead that they would never relinquish. John Tavares, in the neutral zone, tries to break out with the puck. There's a Bruin in his way. He turns back. Ah, there's another Bruin. Somehow does not lose the puck. After he gets out of that little pickle, a Bruin almost takes the puck off him, but he still keeps the puck. Hands it to Willie. Willie brings it in. There's a scramble in front. Rebound comes to Morgan Riley for the tap in. He beats Jeremy Swayman, and the Leafs are up 2-1. Had to feel good for William Nylander to not only get an assist on that goal, but get an assist with John Tavares on the ice after he got demoted. They were in an interesting 4-on-4 situation that allowed for that. And before the period is done, Connor Clifton can't hold the zone in the offensive zone against the Leafs. Alex Kerfoot just flies. Alex Kerfoot makes me realize how fast the Leafs are, that like we don't talk about him as one of the fast ones. Oh yeah, it's Engvall and Mikheyev, and Marner barely gets brought up in that conversation. Kerfoot can fly. And he's got some nasty hands, because he scored a goal against a goalie who can do this. This is Jeremy Swayman just resting, feeling bad after allowing a goal. Leafs had in the first intermission up 3-1 against the Bruins in Boston, with Jeremy Swayman in net. He has been one of the best goalies in the NHL since getting recalled. He should have never been demoted. He should have never been sent back down to the AHL, but the Bruins were like, well, we have Linus Ullmark, and who's this other guy? Oh, Tuukka Rask. And they're like, well, we're not gonna not try Tuukka Rask, so they tried Tuukka Rask. And I think part of the reason it was so easy to be like, ah, Tuukka, that sucks, but you know, best of luck, is Jeremy Swayman. For the Leafs to be up 3-1 against the Bruins in any situation is fantastic. For them to be doing it with Swayman in net, that's something, man. This kid, who the Bruins have in net is special. I really like him. Second period, the Leafs keep at it, capitalizing on the Bruins' mistakes. Breakout pass to Jake DeBrusque is horrible. He can't receive it. Michael Bunting turns it around, gives it to Austin Matthews. Austin Matthews rushing in to Mitch Marner, who shoots now, scores! We're gonna ignore the part where he had a 2-on-0 with Bunting and he passed it to the side of the net. He scored this one! His 28th of the season builds on his career high. The Leafs are up 4-1 in Boston. Fine. It's fine. It's fine. Better to be up 3 goals than down 3 goals. Generally. And with the power play, let me tell you, Austin Matthews scored the most relieving goal ever. His 49th of the season, the Leafs relentless on the power play, will not step off the gas. It is 5-1. 47 seconds later, Morgan Rielly fires it on. David Kampf tips it. 6-1. This one made me feel the best. 4-1 lead? I've seen the Leafs blow a 4-1 lead. I've seen them blow it in that building! But a 5-1 lead? Well, a 5-1 lead, I've seen them blow that too. 6-1 lead? I haven't seen them blow a 6-1 lead. That... Oh, why did I say that out loud? Why on earth would I... Why... Drew, delete this. Drew, can you delete...
Drew, I said delete it!
He didn't delete it, did he? All right, fine, Drew! The Leafs have blown a 5-goal lead. I've seen that when I was a kid, a young lad against the St. Louis Blues. I saw them blow a 5-0 lead. But 5-0 is not 6-1, is it? We saw the Leafs blow a 7-2 lead against the Detroit Red Wings. That's a 5-goal lead. But the Leafs won that game, and 7-2 is not 6-1, is it? Specifically, 6-1, they're fine. Then the Bruins, a minute and a half later, get one. They get one. It goes off Jake DeBrusque's skate. So that they can go into intermission, being like, Marchand, yeah, we'll get to that later. Now, for the third period, there were only 2 goals, and they were both by Boston. Let me explain, now that the game is over, why you shouldn't freak out about that. Because I know there's a number of Leaf fans right now who, geez, they had a 6-1 lead in Boston. They almost blew it. Well, different circumstances to this than most Leaf games where they surrender a bit of a lead. First and foremost, Shelgren played pretty good considering he did not start this game, don't forget. Mrazek allowed 1 goal. It was scored against him by his own teammate. Shelgren comes in. The first goal he allows is a deflection off a skate in front. The second goal he allows is a Curtis Lazar hope and a prayer deflection. He could have played it better, maybe, but who on earth expects that shot? And then with under 3.5 to go, Taylor Hall gets one. It's waved off on the ice and then reviewed and allowed to stand. Now, I don't even have a passionate opinion about it because, do you know what goaltender interference is? Like, here are the arguments. It was already trickling through Shelgren's legs, but Hall moves Shelgren's legs. Does that disqualify him from being eligible to score? But then there's the other factor in me that I can't help because I grew up watching hockey in the 90s where I say, like, I want the Leafs to win, but like, I have a hard time saying that puck went in because Taylor Hall interfered with Eric Shelgren. I have a really difficult time saying that. But then the Leafs just hold the fort with the rookie goalie who did not start the game, and 2 of their 3 right defensemen left the game with injuries. The one thing I will say the Leafs did have going for them, and a lot of Bruins fans said this, was the officiating. The Leafs had way more power play opportunities than the it says here both teams had 3 power play opportunities and both teams were 1 for 3. Well, what's everyone? Oh, that's strange. That's very strange how they use facts like that.
I'm just being salty.
Listen, the Leafs do give up 3 consecutive goals there while trying to defend a 5-goal lead. Given the circumstances, gutsy win. Playing against the Bruins in their own building and losing your starting goaltender immediately puts you at a disadvantage. Playing against a team as good as the Boston Bruins in their own building and losing your starting goaltender and losing your top pair right D puts you at a disadvantage. Playing against a team as good as the Bruins and losing your starting goaltender and losing your top pair right D and losing your second pair right D puts you at a huge disadvantage. Honestly, huge 2 points and a gutsy win. A gutsy win. Now, this is, of course, me after the game, and you know, I got one in me, and I wasn't like that during the game. I do have some footage if you would like to see.
Just close it out for
You know, I could have handled that differently, but the Leafs couldn't have handled that any differently. They did great, and they won. So, the shenanigans. Justin Hall's shenanigans, I mean, it's not anyone's fault. He got hit in the back of the head with a puck, and he ended up leaving the game, and there was blood, and it was scary. And Sheldon Keefe said he's not going to give an update on Hall or Labushkin. That will come Thursday. They have Wednesday off. The shenanigans was that there were coincidental minors. Like, here it is on the score sheet. Justin Hall hooking against Charlie Coyle, served by Jason Spezza. Charlie Coyle holding the stick against Justin Hall. Which is it? Dude, Justin Hall is like weakly one-handed behind the bat. That's hooking? This is hooking now. Here's me impeding you as I fall. Oh my god. That, I thought, was pretty ridiculous. Michael Bunting did have a few good plays in this game, but he's gotta be more disciplined. There's a line you gotta walk, and part of me wonders if he was just trying to build room for himself for the future. The trip, I mean, that's not building room, that's just a bad penalty, but the retaliatory penalty against Charlie McAvoy. See, I didn't realize until I read it there that Bunting and Charlie McAvoy got coincidental unsportsmanlike penalties. Originally, I thought it was interference for McAvoy and roughing for Bunting. The unsportsmanlike here suggests that McAvoy was never going to get a penalty, and it wasn't retaliation from Bunting. So, good for him. Like, I don't know, if he's going to hit you, hit him. It is what it is. I take back any criticism of Michael Bunting there. And then the piece de resistance, Taylor Hall, 2 minutes for roughing on Ilya Labushkin. Dude, listen, do I blame Taylor Hall for being upset about that hit? No, I don't. I don't think it was that bad. I could understand why in the moment he didn't like it and would have thought it was bad. I don't blame him for getting up and getting angry at all. But he sucker punches Ilya Labushkin from behind. And listen, in real time, Bruins fans, I saw that and I was like, why is Labushkin down? I saw a few reporters talking about him acting. The slow-mo cam from the side, though, is gruesome. Hall catches him flush in the jaw. And what we might have called getting your bell rung a few years ago is a concussion. So Taylor Hall, with his glove on, punched Ilya Labushkin in the head so hard that he needed help getting up. And that's 2 minutes? Yeah, sorry, I know Bruins fans probably wanted coincidentals on that one. You're lucky to come out with just 2 minutes. That one, I think, was the most egregious. This is the one I want to spend the most time on, though. Brad Marchand, the unsportsmanlike conduct at the end of the second. Because again, so much happened in this game that I wasn't sure exactly what happened. I thought what happened was Brad Marchand got 2 minutes for cross-checking because he cross-checked John Tavares several times, and then he got a 10-minute misconduct. Here, I look at the notes. Nope. Just the unsportsmanlike at the end of the second, and here's why. He was yipping at the ref. The cross-checks were fine. The National Hockey League cross-check whoever you want. Cross-check him right in the arm. Get him right under there. Get him where there's, right, get him right above the pad. And that's exactly where Marchand is going, that little gap. And he did it more than once, and he's doing it to Toronto's captain to antagonize the captain and to antagonize the rest of the team. And nothing so much for all that game management we always talk about. Good job, guys. I'm always going to be for workers, but NHL officials border on wage theft. So after Marchand does what he does, what ends up getting him the 10-minute misconduct is he wouldn't stop yapping at the ref. So there's his warm-up. There's the standard for the playoffs. Do whatever you want, but do not hurt a ref's feelings. You can cross-check John Tavares until he looks like a weak old banana, but hurt a ref's feelings, you're gonna sit! Listen, Bruins fans, if I can extend any olive branch, you say that the officials were bad in this game, I say, hard agree. All right, now let's get to the questions portion of this video. First one coming from me. How many games do you think Taylor Hall is gonna get? he's not getting any games. He's fine. Have you checked on Adam Wilde? Does he need a Pepto after all that spice at the end of the second? Oh man, Brad Marchand and John Tavares dueling Cereals? Tell you what, if the Leafs play Boston, I don't know how Adam's gonna make it through that series. He's gonna need like Pepto, Gaviscon, all of it. Is there anything better than beating the Bruins in TD Garden? I feel like that question is meant to be celebratory, but instead I have this strange instinct to cry.
I wasn't nervous up 6-1, you were! Brandon, lower your voice! How much is your therapist going to charge for the session for this game? Mine says $67 an hour. Might be time to get a new one.
Ryan, as someone who has gone to therapy for several years, let me just say, I wish my therapist charged $67 an hour. What a bargain! What a... Buddy, you tell me where I can find that, and I'm taking that deal. I'm just kidding, I like my therapist, but that is, that's a deal.
A couple notes before the last question. From Kevin Papetti, Timothy expected goals god Liljegren led the way with an 89.5 XGF percentage tonight. That's expected goals for percentage. Stumbled through that, explained it great. He continues to look awfully comfortable next to Mark Giordano. And then from Jonas Siegel, Mark Giordano's first four games as a Leaf, 79% expected goals.
Sounds good, looks good, and they're going to have to be good because that might be the new second pair if Labushkin and Hall miss next game. I would assume with two righties going out, it's going to be Riley. Brody immediately goes back to the right. It's going to be Giordano, Liljegren, and then Dahlstrom and Joey Duzak from the Marlies? Because they traded Alex Biega and Travis Dermott?
Cool.
Hey, they beat Boston. Remember that.
Last question. Did you enjoy the game?
That's so sweet. That's so kind. Thank you. Genuinely. Yes, I did. I was, sweating a little. Thank you. Yes, I did. Did you? I hope you did. Before we go... Last thing before we go, this is a special announcement. We at SDPN, that's my podcast network that I have with Adam Wilde and Jesse Blake. At SDPN, we are hiring. As you know, Andrew Berkshire has a show/podcast called Game Over Montreal, where he live streams after every single Habs game, and then we make it available afterwards on the SDPN YouTube channel and also on Spotify and a bunch of other sites. Well, we are looking to expand Calgary, Edmonton, Toronto, and Winnipeg. If you think you got what it takes and you would like to apply, visit stpn.ca or a little link in the description down below. But for now, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really like to tell your friends. I can always tell when I've just shot an LFR for a Leafs-Bruins game because I'm sweating after. Like I'm...